So there is a character in here by the name of Jim Johnson, who I know well and is a friend of mine. Have known him for a long time since he worked for the Vice President Mondale. He comes there, and you have a smart focus on him. Yes?
Yes.
What did he do that was different?
Jim Johnson is really a central character in this story because when he arrived at Fannie Mae in 1991, it was kind of a utility. It was a company that had really escaped a near-death experience in the early 80s, had gotten back on its feet financially. But when he came along, it really became, according to people who worked there, a totally political animal. He understood that the government perquisites, the government relationship, the ties to the government were crucial to the success of the company.
Anyway.
Because it meant that they could borrow at cheaper rates than other financial institutions. They also had a $1 billion or plus line of credit with the Treasury. They had all these perquisites that allowed them special, that gave them special treatment. It meant more money for Fannie Mae. And what he understood was he had to protect that at all costs. And so it became this very politically driven machine that was all about protecting the subsidy, protecting the government backing. And that became such a drive that it was no longer really about home ownership. It was about ballooning the balance sheet, expanding into other businesses, growing the earnings so that, in part, he and his executives could take even more money out of the company than they had been previously. Under Jim Johnson, the amount of money that went into the executives' coffers rose dramatically. So it's a man who understood that he had a golden goose that was laying golden eggs, and he could wrap it in the flag of home ownership, allow the thing to grow. He was adept, very adept, at manipulating Congress, making sure that he had friends in Congress to protect the government subsidies, to protect the government relationships. Also extremely
good. But everybody
good.
Does that. Who's in
Everyone does that now,
yeah.
Charlie. I think that this was a person who really had created that blueprint for this kind of a model.
But remember who this person was. I mean, he was a person who was first asked by, was a very great friend of John Kerry.
Yes,
when he ran for president, was a friend of President Obama. President Obama was going to make him head of the transition team.
He was a man who was vetting Obama's vice presidential potential candidate.
And then was also chairman of the Kennedy Center.
Yes, this is a very powerful
man. Mr. Establishment in Washington.
Mr. Establishment.
And hugely respected by you.
Yes, yes. But it is our belief, having done the reporting and having interviewed many, many people that worked there at the time and having seen the outcome and seen the investigations that arose after he had left the scene. He's also very interesting. He's on the board of Goldman Sachs. Mm-hmm. It's what was very interesting to me when we were doing this work was to see how linked Goldman Sachs and Fannie Mae are. There were a lot of interchanging relationships there, which was
Anything
very
fascinating. Anything that you thought was improper?
Nothing improper, but it just is this revolving door between Washington and Wall Street, or this sort of two-way street between Washington and Wall Street that I had forgotten about the level of details.
Now, but that's always been a part of the Washington-Wall Street relationship. I mean,
absolutely.
Robert Rubin, the Secretary of the Treasury, during the Clinton administration, was from Goldman Sachs.
Mm-hmm.
Hank Paulson, the Secretary of the Treasury, was from Goldman Sachs.
Yes.
A whole range of people have come out of these Wall Street firms
When we went into the bailout mode, however, that was very disturbing to a lot of people, the close relationship between Wall Street and Washington.
Join us online at charlierose.com.